morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I know it's 1 minute to, which is really early for us. But we're going to just do any announcements now so that we can move into this fabulously complex and rich worship service that we are putting together this morning. So by way of announcements, let's see. November 19th, which is a Tuesday, we're going to start our Advent study series. I have those books here, so if anybody needs the book, you can see me afterwards. And we'll do that for Christmas and then resume the Adam Hamilton work that we've been doing together after that. This is ecumenical group that's been getting together down at North Conway Community Center. Also, when everybody's here, I'll put introductions, but we have multiple contributors to our worship today, including three facilitators who came from Boston and Vermont to help us have these great conversations about racism and white privilege. And we already had two of those. We had an 8 o'clock gathering and then a 9 o'clock gathering. So we've already started to dig into this, but we won't be done today. This is just a jumping off point for more conversation and more deliberate work. So look forward to January when we'll be going further into this conversation. But at lunch today, Grace, Linda, and Janice will still be here to have yet another conversation with anybody that's missed out so far. So look forward to that after the service. And I would like to welcome Heather and Bernice, who are our worship leaders this morning. And then Jacob and Evelyn would wave. Will you stand up and wave everybody? You're going to hear a beautiful piano music for and after service. Just a smidge, just a taste of what they're capable of. But we are so grateful that you were willing to come and join us this morning. And I think that's everybody that we're trying to fold into worship today. Are there any other announcements, Bob?
This afternoon is the first concert for this local workshop, and that is in Denmark, at the Denmark Performing Arts Center. And then we're doing the same concert next Friday here at 7 o'clock. One this afternoon is at 2 o'clock. So next Friday here at 7 o'clock is the same concert. And the vocal workshop is a group of adults that want to improve their singing skills, and then we do a concert at that. And I also have a great announcement of the grand hall for the second time yesterday. Son and daughter-in-law had a baby girl, Remy.
Remy?
Oh. 7 pounds, 2 ounces.
Grandpa squared. and the theme of the concert this afternoon and next Friday is 1950s, 1960s music. But you should definitely come to the Jackson Country Ball Festival. You know, it's the best. Other announcements for the life of the community or the church. I'm sure I forgot something. I'll probably say at the end of the service or later on instead. There's a full lunch. It's a soup lunch with salad and bread afterwards if you want to save the conversation. You're obviously welcome to come and just nibble and then head out, but we would love it if you want to engage in conversation as well. And with that, if you offer us just a little bit of music. And we're going to, last week we started Novembering. This is a tradition that came with Chris and Isis Church of remembering people that have died. And many people put up names and thoughts last week. But if you didn't get a chance to do that, or if you brought a memento or a photo and you want to add it to the Novembering Tree of Life while we're listening to the music, that would be the time to go ahead. There are little hearts there that you can write somebody's name on and just clip it to the tree while we're hearing Jacob's music. Thank you. Yeah. And so this is your official welcome to Jackson Community Church. We're going to change up how we normally approach service, so for those who don't like passing the keys, you'll be happy to know we're not doing it today. That's where we stand up and we get chaotic and we take hold of each other. We're going to take about 10 minutes to corral us again. So we're going to try to keep moving through our service. So we hope that you'll say hello to each other right after service. I do want to point out that Joyce and Richard Augustine are with us today, and that's a really big deal, and we are thrilled to have both of you here with us and acknowledging Veterans Day and just being in our community.
Entering into a sacred circle, entering into a sacred space, I'll open my heart and quiet my mind for the blessings about to unfold. For the blessings about to unfold. I am entering into a sacred circle, entering a sacred space. I will open my heart and quiet my mind for the blessings about to unfold. For the blessings about to unfold. I am entering into a sacred circle, entering into a sacred space. I will open my heart and quiet my mind.
Let us join together in this common response based on the writings of last week. If there is to be peace in the world,
there will be peace in the nations.
If there is to be peace in the nations,
there will be peace in the cities.
If there is to be peace in the cities,
there must be peace between neighbors.
If there is to be peace between neighbors,
there must be peace in the home.
If there is to be peace in the home,
there must be peace in the heart.
So this song is called May Peace Prevail. The words are very simple. May peace prevail. So on earth. So may peace prevail on earth. May peace. I'm going to sing it through for you one time, okay? And then I'll break it down a little bit if we need to, and then we can all sing together. May peace prevail on earth. May peace prevail on earth. singing, and I would like you to join in, and I'm going to get on with it.
May peace prevail on earth. May peace prevail on earth. May peace prevail. May peace prevail. May peace prevail on earth. May peace prevail.
Who bear scars in their bodies and spirits, and those who came home but struggle to fit in with their families or communities anymore, who have lost
their blessings.
For the family members of those who now serve or once served, and who have made it possible for their loved ones to be on watch at home or around the world or to go into harm's way, would you please rise?
Yes.
death of loved ones who went into harm's way never to return. And for the memories of those who served in times of conflict and peace and have died, we ask your blessing. May be seated. Please pray with me. Almighty God, Brother Christ, God's Spirit, we honor these, your servants, recognizing their commitment and endurance. You promise to be our armor and shield, our fortress and protector. We ask that you will keep all of our veterans and those who love them in your care today. Continue to be present to them and to guard and guide them. You are the Creator who looked upon your world and your children and all is good. You are Yahweh who returned the dove bearing the olive branch after the flood and led us out of slavery to a new land and a new hope. You are the Prince of Peace who defied oppression and injustice, healed where harm was done, and offered your own life to open the way of peace for all people. You are the Spirit who abides with us and draws us more deeply into the courageous creativity of peace building. Grant these your servants, veterans, and those who love them, the peace they have sought to preserve for others. We ask that you will teach all of us, your people, the ways of peace so that those who have sacrificed so much will not have done so in vain. Finally, we give thanks as we renew our continued commitment to bring about the ideals of your kingdom. Here on earth, as well as in heaven, mercy, peace, compassion, and justice for all of your children.
Psalm 52, verses 8 to 9. But I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the steadfast love of God forever and ever. I will thank you forever because of what you have done. In the presence of the faithful, I will proclaim your name, for it is good.
And from Isaiah 41, I will open rivers on the bare heights and fountains in the midst of the valleys. I will make the wilderness a pool of water and dry land springs of water. I will put in the wilderness the cedar, the acacia, the myrtle, and the olive. I will set in the desert the cypress, the plane, and the pine together, so that all may see and know, all may consider and understand that the hand of the Lord has done this. The Holy One of Israel has created it. which is used in our current traditions, even to crown Boston Marathoners. The olive branch, which has been present in ancient writings, those that were offered by Virgil and Ovid, those that were in the Hebrew scriptures from Noah on down, talking about the presence of the olive branch as a sign of abundance, of peace, and victory. In the great national seal for our country, the eagle grabs in one talon an olive branch bearing 13 leaves for the 13 original colonies, and in the other grabs arrows. We live in the tension between these ideas of peace and conflict, and we call out the image of the olive branch again and again to talk about what it means to work towards peace. And on Veterans Day, and on a day when we are having conversations about racism and white privilege, what better theme than to consider the work of peace? Our daughter lives in Manhattan, so we have to go down to New York City to visit her, and Chris and I emerged into Times Square, and there in the middle of Times Square, surrounded by hundreds of neon signs, was a 27-foot bronze, well, the statue, 27 feet height, monumental in scale. And from a distance, you couldn't quite tell who or what we were looking at. It looked like a statue of a Native American. The hair was braided and blown back. He was twisted in the saddle, he had the reins in his left hand, and he had his hand turned this way on a large war horse or some kind of powerful steed. And his clothing was soft and flowing. And we thought, huh, that's really interesting, that was never here before, this 27-foot statue of a man on a horse. And we got up close and the story changed. And we'll go back to that story and why that story is important. The question for us is how we will create peace in our time and in our lives. And why is the conversation about something like racism important up here in a land that's largely white? Why are we trying to dig into things that are so hard to talk about? Because we walk the way of one who chose the hard path. Because peace building isn't something that means absence of conflict, it means actually engaging with conflict. Going to a place where growth and transformation can happen. Where you want more for your children than you have in this world right now. It's been a theme that repeated itself again and again for the last several weeks when we talk about food in the presence of the sacred, in sustainable ways for all people. We got closer to the statue, and it turned out that it wasn't a Native American man. It's a young man of color. And he was sculpted by a sculptor, by an artist who's actually done presidential portraits. His name is Kahinda White. And he'd been to Virginia, and he had seen a statue of a Confederate military leader named Jeb Stuart posed in the exact same posture. Left hand holding the reins. The right hand back, twisted in the saddle, looking straight at you, monumental and heroic. But for Kahinda Wiley, this is a complex narrative. And it gets to the heart of some of our arguments about should we fly the Confederate flag? Should we take down and move the statues that memorialize people that were oppressing others? His response to that statue was to create a new one. It's created in the image combined of the person that posed for it and Trayvon Martin. The soft flowing clothing that he's wearing is a hoodie. And a pair of jeans torn at the knees and sneakers. He's been turned into a heroic figure. Because the narrative of that flag and the narrative of those monuments, whether you're on the Union side or the Rebel side, memorializes only one part of the story, and it doesn't tell so much else. And so the Hindawati's response was to create a new figure in whom he could see himself, in whom other young men of color could see somebody who is a leader, somebody to be valorized and recognized and honored, just the way these other veterans of different battles had been raised up to be honored in the statues that he echoed. It stands in a body of thousands of people moving all the time and backlit by hundreds of neon signs, and it'll only be there for a few months. And then it moves down to Virginia to the museum that commissioned the statue to stand alongside the other ones that are already present as a counter narrative to the narrative that is already told. Kahindawati didn't shut down the conversation, and he didn't say hide the monuments and hide the flags. He said, we need to be part of the conversation, and we have to change the conversation, and this is how I can do it. I will hold up to you what you hold up to me, but now I see myself in it, and can you see me? Peace building is not when you step back and you say nothing and you do nothing. Peace building is courageous conversation. It's two women who drive from Boston and another who drives from Vermont. It's the singing of voices in a circle that invite us all to sing about peace. It's the lives of the people that honor today on Veterans Day, those who serve. Who serve for freedom and democracy and an ideal that we have yet to fully achieve. In World War II, we passed a law right after World War II, the GI Bill, so that people could buy homes and have education. But Southern Democrats made sure that this bill would not benefit men of color who had served in the military. Men who put their lives on the line and came home again, and thought they could buy a home and go to college and better their families' lives because they had served this nation, to fight and to stand up for its ideals, were left out of the dream. It is one more way that we did a disservice to people who came here not even of their own volition but as slaves, and were then beat down by Jim Crow laws, and then by deliberate acts like this to institutionalize racism, and then mass incarceration. At the 8 o'clock and the 9 o'clock services, we had these conversations about how we engage in this work of peace building, to become aware of the full nature of our story and the things that we've accomplished and the things that we have yet to accomplish. Institutions are partially responsible for holding on to racism, but so are we in our individual lives. And here, in our own conversations, telling our own stories and hearing each other's stories, being curious, being brave, and not being quiet anymore in the face of injustice, but beginning to do the work to see each other fully and to make sure that all people have a place at the table and a place in our nation with a voice and a vote and all the things that they need to flourish. This is how we begin that work. We begin it sitting in a circle, getting to know each other, or sitting down at a meal and asking each other questions and being curious, and coming away learning one new thing about ourselves and someone else. It isn't something that's going to happen in one day or overnight. The women that are coming up from Boston have been doing this work in their own church for 24 years? 12 years formally, and then a good deal. Like another 10 before that. It took 10 years to get their church to even agree to have a team to have the conversations. And they've been going at it for 12 years, working on what it means to be welcoming and inclusive and self-aware. We're just beginning that work here. But if you wonder if the story of the Confederate flag matters here, remember what made it into NPR a year ago. And I had to learn it this week because somehow I missed it, so shame on me. We had 12 students of color out of 800, perhaps, at Kennett High School. And two of them are fast friends and have been experiencing racism since kindergarten. And then sometime around 2015, it became very popular to fly the Confederate flag on a truck or to wear it to school. That's one thing, but these boys were targeted. People would stuff the image of the Confederate flag into their backpacks or walk up to them specifically and say, "Hey, just see what I'm wearing." And the boys talked to the administration about it, and the administration outlawed the use of the image of the Confederate flag. But the students asked for more. They asked for a panel and a conversation and education about what does this flag mean. Not because they wanted erase from history, but because they want people to be aware of what it means to walk up to a person of color and shove it in their face. That happened in our high school. And because one of our students left this state and left our high school, because it wasn't safe to be here anymore. But the administration didn't find it useful to have that conversation. They simply went with the ban and let it be. So where are those conversations going to happen if they can't happen in the school? The library is courageous. There are being conversations about one book, one ballot, and transgender issues. It's our turn to have these conversations, to be courageous, to lift up diversity in our world and what it means to wage peace, to work for peace, to open our eyes, to know who we are, and to know what we aspire to be. This is far from hopeless. Circumstance, it is a hopeful one. When we honor veterans who believe in the ideals of democracy and peace and freedom, it is so that we can have these courageous conversations and do this work and expand the freedoms and the rights of all people in this nation, starting in this village and in this valley, and working out from our own hearts the greater world. It matters that Kahinduwai put himself into the sculpture and other young men of color. And it matters that we have these conversations. We cannot be silent in the face of injustice and racism and anything that threatens freedom and the rights of all people. This is the call of the olive branch. It is to work for peace. And it isn't easy, and it does take courage to sit down at the table and have the conversation, but it is necessary. Thank you, God.
Love as you are, love as you are in
time that we ask for your help, that we can help others. This church is a safety net. I'm going to encourage you to say it again and again. But there are families with children, a veteran, two veterans, this week came to the weigh station and took away four bags of food because they had to choose between transportation and feeding their children. We help each other. We lift each other up. Do what we can.
All the world.
Brothers and sisters, you are the children of light, and you are the peacemakers. You are the workers of change and hope in this world. The work of peace begins now and here in your hearts and goes out the door with you into your lives. Carry peace with you, within you and in your hands.